find a seat. There's many at the front.
Push the front, yeah, push it.
Okay.
Before we begin, I'm going to invite Hans Peters to give some instructions on the interpretation that we'll be doing Spanish to English. Come.
Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome here. If you speak English, you don't need to know about what I'm going to talk about now. So, ¿quién aquí habla español? Levanta la mano, por favor. ¿Alguien? Algunos, okay. Si necesitan traducción, ahí en la mesa por ahí atrás pueden recibir un aparatito como este que les va a permitir recibir la traducción que van a hacer la señora y el señor por ahí atrás en la mesa por ahí atrás. Así que si ellos están murmurando y hablando por ahí atrás, no se den la vuelta. If they're talking back there and murmuring, they're not bugging you. They're translating, okay? Así que si reciben uno de estos, van a pedir que les den sus nombres y anotan por ahí para que sabemos quién lo tiene. Lo único que tienen que hacer es enchufar los auriculares en el aparato, ponerlo en la oreja y hay un botón aquí que dice fuerza o power. Aplastan eso y todo va a estar listo. No necesitan nada más. Eso es lo uno. Y lo otro, and the other thing is for the speakers. If you're a speaker here, to help the interpreters, please enunciate the words. Secondly, please speak slowly. Also, use short sentences. It makes it a lot easier for us. Don't use idioms, because it's really hard to translate
to English. It's too late for that.
I knew it. Don't use colloquialisms either. Oh yeah, and if you see a yellow card, it'll say slow. That means we're having a hard time keeping up, so slow down when you're speaking, speakers. You know what it's like in soccer. If you get a yellow card, it's a warning. If you get a red one, you're out. That means please stop. We gotta catch up. Let's lift the yellow card if we're ready to go. I think that's it.
So welcome, bienvenue, bienvenido, willkommen, sego, ani. My name is Marlene Eck, and together with my co-chair, Raina Neufeld, and the conference coordinator, Meredith Clausen, I welcome you to the Global Mennonite Peace Building Conference and Festival. We hope that your travel to this place was enjoyable and not too difficult. We regret that 10 of our friends and colleagues are not in attendance because their visas were not accepted. A few others were unable to attend for other reasons. And we will bring our concerns about the visa denial to our Canadian government after the conference. Despite our sadness for those who are absent, I feel the anticipation and excitement in this place for 4 days of inspiration, reflection, and conversation. This gathering is a historic opportunity for people of peace from around the world to come together to reflect and debate on past, present, and future challenges for Anabaptist Mennonites who want to address conflict and violence in their homes, in their communities, and in their national contexts. We begin by acknowledging that we are on the traditional territory of the neutral Anishinaabe and Haudenosaunee peoples. The University of Waterloo is situated on the Haldimand Tract, the land promised to the Six Nations Indigenous peoples that includes 6 miles on each side of the Grand River, which you may have crossed on your way here. Mennonites were the first white settlers to live permanently on this land. And behind me, outside this wall, is a garden with a plaque that marks the 1805 land purchase by Mennonites from Pennsylvania. The story that this marker presents is incomplete because we also need to recognize the history and peoples that were here before and are still here as well. And so when the conference and the construction ends, we will be transforming this garden, which I encourage you to go look at when you're outside. We will transform it as part of our wish and responsibility to seek reconciliation with our Indigenous neighbors. In that spirit, I am happy to welcome representatives from the Waterloo Aboriginal Education Center to offer their own invitation to this space.
I'm a Dishnikaz, Mikeshnanhidra, Mayangadigan. I'm an Anishinaabe student here at UW. And I'm just going to say a few words in my language, which is Anishinaabe, and it's a traditional language, an indigenous language here. Miigwech, Dijamido, Kinegago, Gamijan, Miigwech, Afian, Kinegago, Gamijan, Miigwech, Chibi, Kinegago, Gamijan. And that's just thanking the creator, the land, and the water for being here and doing it all it does for us. We're going to sing some songs for you now. The first song is Heikwadude, and it's a Mi'kmaq welcoming song. And it's just to get a good space here and good energy for everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you for joining us and welcoming us to this space. And we will welcome you back when we transform our garden. Thank you. Well, greetings, guests from many continents and countries from around the world, and a warm welcome to Canada, to the province of Ontario, to the city of Waterloo, and to our campus, Conrad Grable. We are a Mennonite Liberal Arts College affiliated with the University of Waterloo. I am Susan Schultz-Huxman, president of Conrad Grable University College, and on behalf of all of our faculty, and staff, and students, and Board of Governors, we are very pleased to welcome you to the Global Mennonite Peace Building Conference and Festival from June 9th to the 12th. We welcome diverse voices of expertise and experience on an expansive repertoire of peace topics. Pastors and poets, welcome. Professors and peace practitioners, welcome. Artists and advocates, welcome. We welcome all of you from Africa, Asia, the Americas, and Europe, 18 countries in all. We welcome a globally engaged dialogue, and we are eager to experience a rich cross-cultural mosaic on peace issues in all of its forms and expressions. Conrad Grable University College is uniquely positioned, we think, to host this historic gathering. We are the oldest and largest peace studies program in Canada. And we are the only Mennonite institution of higher learning in North America to be associated with a world-class research university, the University of Waterloo. That vibrant partnership gives us size and scale and influence to leverage our values as an Anabaptist-inspired liberal arts college. We are committed, in word and deed, to our distinctive mission to seek wisdom, nurture faith, and pursue peace and justice in service to church and society. I want to, at this time, pay a special tribute to our many fine sponsors and supporters of the conference. Without their enthusiastic support, shared vision, and generous financial contributions, we could not have dreamed so big to offer this kind of conference experience. So first, I would like to acknowledge the overall conference supporter, the Mennonite Savings and Credit Union. We have representation from them here today or not. If you are here, maybe you could raise your hand. We'll say just a word about them. The Mennonite Savings and Credit Union, MSCU as we call them, was founded at the same time as Conrad Grable in the early 60s by some of the same visionaries who shared the same enduring Mennonite values. Grounded in Anabaptist faith, the MSCU is a healthy, vibrant, and growing financial institution committed to stewardship, mutual aid, economic justice, and service to others. We hope that you have a chance to visit our fourth floor, which houses the MSCU Center for Peace Advancement. It is our newest venture in entrepreneurial and innovative peacemaking at the college. I also want to acknowledge the sponsor of this plenary session, MITA. If you would stand at this time, we know that business solutions to poverty are very much a part of the global peace agenda. We have a dozen other key corporate sponsors that I'd love to acknowledge, but they won't let me. They'll put the stock card up for me. You will find them on page 13, and I'd like you to go to that now. These are the 13 corporate sponsors with their visual identities. Please, let's give them a hand. I want to close by saying, as history teaches us, persuasive voices of peace and faith-inspired shalom
often come from unlikely places and from unusual people. Peace is a counterculture message of the power of reconciling love and uncommon courage. From Martin Luther King to Mother Teresa, from Nelson Mandela to Oscar Romero, from Malala Yousafzai to Muhammad Ali, these uncommon voices, unlikely voices, shook up the world to give peace a chance. May these inspirational peace voices resonate with us this week. Thank you all and welcome.
Welcome. I am Raina Neufeld, the other co-chair, along with Marlene Allen. Resist not evil, turn the other cheek. Love your enemies. Matthew 5:38. The sword is outside the perfection of Christ. Schleichheim Confession, 1527. Render to no one evil for evil or cursing for cursing. Put the sword into the sheath. Beat the swords into plowshares. Even if necessity require it, flee for the Lord's sake from one city or country into another, and suffer the spoiling of our goods, that we must not harm anyone. And when we are smitten, rather turn the other cheek also than take revenge or retaliate. Dordrecht Confession, 1623. Non-resistance, defenselessness, conscientious objection, alternative service, restorative justice, peacemaking, conflict transformation, peace building. These are some of the words that have framed the Anabaptist Mennonite call to be part of God's peaceable kingdom, a call Mennonites have heard from the 16th century until the 21st century. Today, Mennonites have become known globally for responding to this call, even while our responses have changed over the centuries. Now, many people know of Mennonites because of the proactive work in restorative justice, conflict transformation, and peace building. For this conference, you'll notice we're using the overarching term, peace building. This is intended to embrace the history, this impressive history and wide variety of peace-related work that it has generated over the centuries. While Anabaptist Mennonites have gained recognition for our historic position and contemporary work, we also know there are areas where we have failed, and from which we must learn if we are to further live out this call to peace. Our history of arriving and settling on imperial lands is a good example, being complicit in structures from which we benefit, but which harm others. We have also often failed to deal constructively with conflict in our conferences, in our churches, and even to respond to the conflict and violence hidden in our homes. Over the next 3 days, we are gathered together to explore traditions and contemporary expressions of Anabaptist Mennonite peace beliefs and practices. We're bringing together academics and practitioners to learn from one another, to give expression to peacebuilding through the arts, and to assess and re-envision Mennonite peacebuilding practice together. If you've looked at your program, you know we have a rich and full agenda. We have structured the conference to include what we have called a reflective learning agenda. And the purpose of this is to draw out from presentations, conversations, artistic provocations, reflections on our focus, Anabaptist Mennonite peacebuilding. And there are 5 questions we invite you to join with us in thinking through while we're here together. Who are we as Anabaptist Mennonite peacebuilders? What do or did we do? With what issues do we wrestle? What has changed over time? Where are we going? Some of us will reflect on these questions from the vantage point of being a self-identified Mennonite and Anabaptist. Others will help us reflect on these questions from their vantage point as friends, colleagues, and partners on the road to peace. Like musical motifs, we invite you to think through these questions when you hear stories of building peace told by different Mennonite voices during the morning plenaries, the concurrent sessions, the song Earth Peace Tonight, The Banquet, and the play Yellow Bellies. You can also keep these questions in mind throughout the concurrent sessions, which are on a myriad of topics. The conversation cafes that are listed in your schedule are held Friday and Saturday afternoons, and they'll provide us with a place to enjoy refreshments and each other's company, as well as a space to enter into deep conversation about these questions. There are two teams of people helping with the reflective learning agenda that I want to introduce to you. One team is called the Conversation Cafe team. These people are running the cafe and they invite, and I'm going to invite you to stand up as I call your name. It's led by Jennifer Ball. Jennifer, where is there at the back? And it includes Rod Friesen. Is Rod here? Not yet. Paul Stuckey. Translating, hidden from some. Esther Aptison. And Regina Shan-Stoltz, who I know is also not here yet. So thank you. And we're going to hear back from this Conversation Cafe team in our final plenary on Sunday. The second team that's helping me with this learning agenda is the listening team. This is a group of six people that are comprised of three unusual or surprising pairs. Their task, as the name suggests, is to listen. They're going to fan out over the conference and listen in pairs and give feedback on our final plenary Sunday morning. The team is put together to bring a variety of life experiences and perspectives on Mennonite peacebuilding. They have different disciplinary and or NGO backgrounds. They come from different geographic locations. And several also bring particular artistic sensibilities to their task. We're encouraging this group to be creative, to bring an artistic flair to their contributions. And so this team, please stand up as I call your names, they include Sarah Brubaker, Myra Liguro, Jeff Gundy, Andreas Pacheco, Lozano, and then pinch hitting, we have Ron Matthews and Christo Johnson Weichsel. Thank you. Thank you. This is one of the cases where our visas have affected our composition. Finally, most of you, I hope, have a stone. And you're probably wondering, what am I doing with this stone? And if you don't have one yet, you can pick one up on your way out, or they're ready to hand them out if need be. You might be puzzled by this plain stone. If you have one, feel the weight of your stone. If not, look at your neighbor's stone. Look at its color, its texture. Pockmarks, mine has pockmarks and a lot of imperfections. These stones, like the contributions people are going to make at this conference, are actually very beautiful in their variations. Each has its own story to tell, and it's going to become part of our story as we attend to them. And when we pay attention, we notice things about our stones. These stones in your hands come from this place. Some even come from my garden, I confess. We give you this stone to hold with you while you are here. And on the last day of the conference, I'm going to ask, and the team together is going to ask you to bring them back with a word that captures an insight or learning or a hope that you have from being here. Together then, we're going to build a stone marker. There is a long biblical tradition of building stone markers at times of transition. And these markers help to make safer the space in which we stand. They help us to remember. And each time that we pass, it helps us remember what God has done or is doing. This marker we will create will help us both remember our past efforts, as well as help to remind us of what we have yet to do on our journey to being a people of God's peace. The stones will serve as a reminder to you. In days to come, your children will ask you, what do the stones mean? Tell them. Adapted from Joshua 4, 6, and 7. Thank you for listening. It's time to sing. I am happy to introduce Professor Mark Vornin, who's a conductor and member of our music department at Conrad Grebel. And he's going to lead us in the singing of We Are People of God's Peace. And you will find a copy of this in your folder. So we made copies for everyone. So please get it out. Thank you, Mark. Services that begin by students and faculty and staff passing the peace of Christ or greeting each other with a handshake or an elbow or a fist bump or a hug of peace. And so I'd invite you to turn to your neighbor. Don't start the Mennonite game or anything, please. But greet each other. Share your name and say what your place of origin was to get to this place today and pass the peace as you wish. So we'll just take a few moments for that.
Thank you.
get out of control. To set the context for the dialogue that will take place at the GMP, and over the last 2 years that we've been working on this event, we have simply come to call it the GMP. So feel free to use the acronym. As we were planning, we decided to invite three important thinkers and voices on Anabaptist Mennonite Peace Building to lead us into the conference theme. I will introduce all of them at this time, and then they will proceed one after the other. First of all, Fernando Enns. Fernando is professor of theology and ethics at the Free University in Amsterdam, Netherlands, and director of the Institute of Peace Church Theology at the University of Hamburg. Originally from Brazil, he is vice chair of the Mennonite Church in Germany and sits on the Central Committee of the World Council of Churches. Fernando has spoken and published extensively on the value of an ecumenical peace movement. His publications include The Peace Church and the Ecumenical Community, Ecclesiology and the Ethics of Nonviolence, Just Peace, Ecumenical, Intercultural and Interdisciplinary Perspectives, and most recently, Mennonites in Dialogue, Reports from International and National Ecumenical Encounters. He will speak on the theme, Anabaptist Mennonite Peace Building, Global Church Engagement. Then we will hear from Paulus Wijaya. Paulus is director of the Center for the Study and Promotion of Peace and teaches in the Faculty of Theology at Duta Wacana Christian University in Yogyakarta, Indonesia. In that capacity, he oversees and participates in trainings in mediation and conflict resolution for individuals from many religious and ethnic groups throughout the Asia-Pacific region. He is past chair of the Peace Commission of Mennonite World Conference and is a member of the Muria Christian Church in Indonesia. Paulus is co-editor of A Culture of Peace, God's Vision for the Church, and Overcoming Violence in Asia, the Role of the Church in Seeking Cultures of Peace. And he will speak on the theme, Anabaptist Mennonite Peace Building, Interfaith and Interethnic Reconciliation. Lisa Shirk is research professor at the Center for Justice and Peace Building at Eastern Mennonite University in Harrisonburg, Virginia, United States. She is also North American Research Director for the TODA Institute for Global Peace and Policy Research and Senior Policy Advisor with the Alliance for Peace Building. She is a consultant on peace building and human security for organizations around the world. Lisa has written numerous books, including many of the little books, Ritual and Symbol in Peace Building, The Little Book of Strategic Peace Building, and The Little Book of Dialogue for Difficult Subjects. Her most recent book is Conflict Assessment and Peace Building Planning Toward a Participatory Approach to Human Security. Lisa will speak on the theme, Anabaptist Mennonite Peace Building Within a Tribe Called Mennonite. Please join me in welcoming our three guest speakers.
And this is Brian. Right. I think he deserves an applause too. Without him, we would be lost here. Dear sisters, and I may say brothers, feel included, as you wish. It is great to be here. Thank you for the warm welcome. Thank you for inviting us to this space. It is really a privilege to be here. I must say, some of us have been dreaming of such a conference for a long time. Because we always thought, well, all these Mennonites do so many great things around the world. They are known for their peace-building projects in universities, in some activities, in advocacy work, in politics. But these Mennonites usually find themselves very isolated and disconnected to some other Mennonites. So why don't we bring together people, Mennonites, and have a Mennonite peace-building conference? That would be great. So here we are, and this is really, really wonderful. Thank you so much for organizing this. I will not name you all, but I mean, you have been in touch with these women, with these sisters, and they have helped us immensely to get here. Thank you so much. I'm filled with this feeling of gratefulness, so I want to invite you just for a moment of prayer before I start. God of life, God of justice and peace, we thank you for this space, a space that you have created, that you have provided, that you have prepared. You invite us into your wisdom of peace with justice. Bless us as we encounter with each other, as we learn from each other, as we listen from each other, as we share. Walk with us through the coming hours and days, and bless this university, all the people that are studying here together in order to find out more about your wisdom of peace building. Amen. Thank you. Well, it's great to be here, and I must say I've only been here for almost 24 hours, and it already feels like, yeah, it's worth it. We don't really need a program, you know. This is the thing with Mennonite conferences. It's, you don't really have to set up a program, but you know, meeting some of you, being able to talk to you, seeing friends again, getting to know new people, even in the shared bathroom that we have in the morning. You know, you cannot but talk peace all the time here. So it's really great. But of course, we are looking forward to the program as well. Now, I want to talk a little bit, 15 minutes, that's the maximum. I don't see there's a clock. Well, Marlene will remind us here that we keep time, 15 minutes, as you have seen. This is very, very, very limited. I will try my best to follow that. I'm invited to speak a bit about Anabaptist Peace Building Global Church Engagement. Well, of course, if you're invited to do that and you're given 15 minutes, that's 1-5, right? I mean, that's almost when you think like, okay, they don't know what they're doing. Anyway, you want to be peaceful and you say, okay, let's try. So what I will do is I will focus. I will have to focus as much as possible, and I will focus on the involvement of Mennonites in the World Council of Churches. This World Council of Churches, as many of you may know, is consisting at this moment of 345 member churches from around the world, and representing around 500 million Christians. So the Mennonite peace building in this World Council of Churches is probably a small voice, sometimes not even recognized, but still it is present in this worldwide movement. And I want to take you, before I take you a bit of that history, I want to start with two theses. Number one, the peace theology and the peace witness of the peace churches would not be the same today if it had not been developed in dialogue with the other churches. So it's about the influence of the others on the peace churches. And secondly, the engagement for peace and justice of the Worldwide Fellowship of Churches would not be the same today if the peace churches had not been actively involved in the ecumenical movement. So this is about the peace churches on the others, the influence. I want to take you to some of the milestones of this ecumenical movement very, very briefly, very superficially, of course, but just to draw some lines here. In order to remind you of some of the things that have happened. The founding of the World Council of Churches in 1948. War is contrary to the will of God. That was the strong motivation and the consensus of the churches after the devastating experience of two world wars and the involvement of the churches in those wars. And some Mennonites joined this global church movement from the beginning. It was the Dutch Mennonites and the German Mennonites. They are among the founding members of the World Council of Churches. And they were the only Mennonite churches who would join at that moment. Over the decades, it was only the Mennonite community in Congo that has joined us as well. So the Mennonites were not the strongest peace churches in representation in this council, but there were other peace churches. It was the Quakers, the Friends, the Church of the Brethren, who have started that movement together with us Mennonites. And I must say, MCC, Mennonite Central Committee, to my knowledge, they have sent to every single assembly representatives, they have stayed in touch with this global ecumenical movement from the beginning. Not being an official member, of course, but being present and staying in touch. Now the PDU conferences, some of you might know about these PDU conferences, very, very famous, very rich in content, 1955 to 1973. It was the first General Secretary of the World Council of Churches, with the name Willem A. Visserhoofd, a Dutchman, who challenged the peace churches to present their arguments for a pacifist position to the Worldwide Fellowship of Churches. Since all other theologies seem to have failed preventing those devastating world wars. And the peace churches responded with a famous document titled Peace is the Will of God. Note the change in phrasing it. It's not a negative phrase, it's a positive phrase. It became the initiation of a long and very rich, heated debate sometimes between representatives of the small peace churches and the large traditions of state churches. Since the 16th century Reformation, Mennonites had not been challenged like this to defend and to propose their convictions on non-resistance. And it is here that we find the emergence of a very rich peace theology and the sharpening of all major ethical arguments against any participation of Christians in war. Especially when the younger churches from the Global South were joining these conversations, it became even more complicated because the topic of revolutionary violence was an issue. Revolutionary violence against the injustices of colonialism. 1983, in this wonderful country, on the other side, Vancouver, the Sixth Assembly of the World Council of Churches, starting a conciliar process on justice, peace, and the integrity of creation. It is in this process that the churches all together have learned to understand that a convincing peacefulness cannot restrict itself to being against war or reducing the whole topic of peace to a controversy between peace churches and non-pacifist churches. Here we see a widening of the horizon for all of the churches, including us. Peace cannot be discussed without the question of justice. And both justice and peace are closely related to our self-understanding and our perspectives on nature. We are part of creation and not the lords of creation. We are called to be responsible housekeepers. The peace churches were challenged by this widening of the horizon as much as the other churches. Together, they continued to discuss the old questions within that new framework, following a methodology called a conciliar process, a peace witness in itself, I want to say. Jumping to the 8th Assembly of the World Council of Churches in Harare, Zimbabwe, 1998. The promise of a new era of peace after the end of the so-called Cold War between East and West, which of course, as we know, was a hot war in most parts of this world. did not become a reality. That promised peace did not become a reality. Another widening of the horizons of peace building was needed to challenge the whole range of experiences, different experiences of violence. Direct and personal violence, indirect and structural violence, cultural violence, and so on. People are killed even when there is no war. People are killed by criminal acts. People are killed by hunger. People are killed by domestic violence. People are killed by discrimination. People are killed by racism, and so on. Churches together were committing themselves here in Harare to overcome the spirit, logic, and practice of violence. That was one of the goals of this decade, to overcome violence. And Mennonites, being one of the smallest member churches of the World Council, had initiated this new approach. The Decade to Overcome Violence resulted in an international ecumenical peace convocation in Jamaica in 2011. Throughout that first decade of the new millennium, churches witnessed additional and yet new challenges. For example, internationally operating terrorism and the so-called war on terror. And again, some of those old questions came back in a different manner. How to protect those who cannot protect themselves? Should we really say that military interventions are never appropriate, witnessing a genocide in Rwanda? Again, it took the strong witness of the peace churches to prevent the mainline churches from falling back into their old way of reasoning for just war. Instead, the fellowship of churches moved on together in heated debates again to develop a comprehensive understanding of just peace, developing new ways of theological reflection, political reasoning, and practical conflict transformation. The 10th Assembly, the latest Assembly of the World Council of Churches, took place in Busan in South Korea, 2013. This latest Assembly chose as its general motto a prayer: God of life, lead us to justice and peace. The proposed centrality of peace and justice in this Assembly within a multi-religious context in Asia was one of the results of that previous decade to overcome violence. The Fellowship of Churches has learned that peace and justice are at the very heart of Christian faith and witness in this world. And accordingly, at that assembly in Busan, a new and overall programmatic approach has been chosen that should guide all future activities and reflections of the World Council of Churches, a pilgrimage of justice and peace. And in one of the workshops, we will talk more about that. At least three insights need to be highlighted here. One, the churches of that global fellowship are seeing more clearly now than ever before that building peace with justice is a journey of faith. It is a process of formation. Secondly, the churches are learning that they themselves need to walk the way of justice and peace. They have to become themselves communities of justice and peace if they want to be faithful disciples on the way of Jesus. And thirdly, the churches are committing themselves to explore the spiritual roots of just peace in order to be transformed and to be empowered to walk that pilgrimage together. Now, Mennonites have been heavily involved in developing this programmatic approach, and we continue to be so. The guiding principle for this fellowship of churches at this very moment, inviting all people of goodwill to to walk with us on the way of just peace. Now to conclude, let me be a bit more precise about my thesis here. The peace theology and the peace witness of the peace churches would not be the same today. Sorry, I have to read from that slide. But I changed it. I learned myself while I was listening to myself, you know. The peace theology and the peace witness of the peace churches would not be as broad today if it had not been developed in dialogue with the other churches. And secondly, the engagement for peace and justice of the worldwide fellowship of churches would not be as central today if the peace churches had not been actively involved in that ecumenical movement. To conclude, my experience as a representative of that Mennonite voice within the World Council of Churches is that our voice is needed and it is appreciated. We are welcome at the ecumenical table. And on the other hand, there's so much to learn for us by walking with the others, since there's so much wisdom on peace building within the other traditions that we don't own yet. So to be a peace church obviously means to be ecumenical. Thank you very much.
Vijaya, and as Fernando has said, I have been asked also to talk about 15 minutes, and it's not comparable at all with 41 hours that I took to fly from Yogyakarta to Toronto. So you can imagine, I flew 41 hours only to speak for 15 minutes. the topic that I've been asked to talk is about the inter-ethnic and inter-religious reconciliation. And I take the risk to speak about these two interchangeably within inter-ethnic. I do not know what is this song. I take the risk to talk about the inter-ethnic and inter-religious interchangeably because yes, there are some differences between the two kinds of conflict, and yet there are also so many commonalities between these two kinds of conflicts. So I would like to start by asking a question: what is the problem? And I draw from the Indonesian experience. I think the problem is not on the ethnicity or religion itself, but it is in the social construction of violence, because I do not believe that somebody does violence to others just because the others have different ethnicity or different religion. So I think that it is a myth to say something like that, that I believe that it is more on the social construction of violence. And this social construction of violence is very true, because if we imagine that people are in conflict between each other just because they have different ethnicities or different religions, then you can imagine that each group of people will tend to hide in their own enclave, and then there is no society at all. But the fact shows that that is not the case. Society still exists, so meaning that people do not kill each other just because they have different ethnicity or different religion, but there is a social setup that make those people to kill each other. That is my thesis. So, the social construction of violence is not related to primary primordialism, but to a secondary one. So each of us is born in a primordial community. That is true, and it is natural. And yet, when we claim that our group is superior compared to the other groups, that is what I call secondary primordialism, and that is dangerous, because that secondary primordialism that encourages us to eliminate the others, and it is intentional, and it also corrupts our heart and mind. So we starting to narrate or to tell stories about conflict. We choose a special particular traumas, and we generate it from generation to generation so that people keep remembering about the conflict. So it is intentional. It is not just happen, but it is intentional. And the social construction of violence then will make us exclude each other. We do not embrace each other, but we tend to eliminate each other. And this social construction of violence, in my experience in Indonesia, becomes stronger when it gets a religious legitimation. And this is very interesting. My late professor, James McClendon Jr., said that what he called, with the phrase, this is death. So when he is saying that, he is encouraging us, the Christian community, to remember the early Christian communities, and that our communities should become like that. So this is death. So that we model the early Christian communities. But in Indonesia, it's very interesting that this kind of phrase becomes a religious legitimation that brings people into conflict. And I think the problem is depending on the death here. Because what we mean by the death? Because this death is the imagined community. What we imagine about our community is, and this kind of community, it becomes a conservative term. Family. Yeah, I can explain it later. Here, what I mean. Among the Muslim, so among the Muslims in Indonesia, the death, this is death. So our community is death, and what they mean by death is the Middle East Islamic countries, especially the Saudi Arabia and the Palestine. So this is death. So they imagine that the community in Indonesia, the Muslim community, becomes like the Saudi Arabian. And the Muhammad Ibn Abdul Wahab becomes the prominent figure in the imagined community. And this is the person who created the Wahhabi purification movement. And he also established the first Saudi Arabian state. So the radical Muslims imagining themselves to become like that, like the Wahhabi movement. That brings the purification in society. Whereas for the Christians, on the other hand, so they, it's very interesting that in the beginning, previously, the Christians in Indonesia looked at the Netherlands as their imagined community. We would like them, and therefore you can see in the church, the Dutch languages are still used, and many Dutch terms were also used in the church. But then it moves to USA as the imagined community, and now it is Israel. That is the imagined community. So people like to become like Israel, the Christian churches in Indonesia. And so now when the Christian gather together, they will shout it, Shalom, Shalom, because that is the greetings, the Christian greetings. They would like to pretend something like Israel. And Jesus is called Yeshua HaMashiach, It's not Jesus Christ, but Yeshua HaMashiach. That is the term that is used. And God is called Yahweh. It's not God, because they said no. He has a name that is Yahweh. So the Christian becomes like Israel, and the Muslim becomes like the Saudi Arabian. And it is very impressive that among the Christians that it is not Moses who become the figure, the prominent figure, but Joseph and David, that is the prominent figure among the Christian among the Christian communities. It is very interesting for me because who they pick up as the prominent figure is not the religious figure, but the political figure. So Joseph, he is a minority, and yet he becomes and he could have a very high position in the government, as well as David. David also becomes a king, even though he has to conquer Goliath, that is the giant. So that is very interesting, and you can imagine that now in Indonesia you can see the purifier versus the superior minority, because the Muslims want to become like the Wahhabi, who bring the purification to the religion, even to the society, and then the Christians want to become like Joseph or like David. It is minority, and yet it is a superior minority. And so here is the problem. Miroslav Volf, my professor, said that exclusion can happen in four forms: in elimination, assimilation, domination, or distancing. I can give you some example. The elimination, meaning that we exclude people. This is the worst form of exclusion, that we eliminate people. Genocide in Nazi and Rwanda. In Indonesia, it also happened with the anti-Chinese riot, anti-Chinese violence. So they want to eliminate all kind of Chinese descendants from Indonesia. And also anti-Ahmadiyya. This is a branch of the Muslims. But it is not officially recognized and acknowledged by the Muslims, the mainstream Muslims. So the Ahmadiyya also had to be eliminated. Some people say that Ahmadiyya is actually a Mennonite Muslims, because the Ahmadiyya is very quiet and very peaceful. They strive for peace, and so they call it Mennonite Muslims. But it has to be eliminated. So in Indonesia. Then secondly, assimilation. Assimilation is, well, it's not as worse as the elimination, but this is also a bad thing. The assimilation is we enforce other groups to be eliminated, to be assimilated, and to be put under the dominant identity. And they have to strip off their own identity and have to replace it with the dominant identity. For example, in Indonesia, if you have this Western name, Nikita Willy, for example, it is fine. Nobody will ask about it, and nobody, government will not ask you to change your name. Or if you have Arabic names, Quraishiha, it is also fine. But if you are born with Tan King Boon, this is a Chinese name, then it suddenly it becomes a problem. I was born a Xiao Tian Pa. But the government said, no, you have to change your name. So therefore, I become Paulo Sukung Wijaya. Because, so it is very interesting that if you are born with Western names, it is fine. With Arabic names, it is fine. But with Chinese name, that is a problem. You have to change it. Even in Central Java, where the Mennonite majority live, it used to be a regulation by the government to prohibit the Chinese to eat the Chinese New Year cake. So, because they think that if we eat the Chinese New Year cake, then our Chinese identity becomes stronger. So, we should not eat that Chinese New Year cake. Even though if you look at the Indonesian dietary, you can find a lot of Chinese, menus. There is bak mi, bak moi, bak so, bak pia, bak jang, whatever. And it's very interesting. Bak means pork. And yet it can be accepted, but somehow with the Chinese New Year cake, it is not accepted. And the third kind of exclusion is domination, in which we dominate, we submit other groups, under our power. So this is something like that happens in Rohingya, with the Rohingya or Karen in Burmese. And in Indonesia, there is also this joint regulation between Minister of for Religious Affairs and Minister for Internal Affairs, in which it's stated that if we Christians want to build a church, then we should get, we should provide a proof that there are at least 90 families who will use their church building. That is one. And then secondly, we should have a signature from 60 families around the church building who said that they agree that we will build a church there. And we also should get a recommendation from the local office of Department of Religious Affairs, and also a recommendation from the local inter-religious joint forum. But in this joint forum, of course, usually is represented only with one person, or it's just one person among so many other Muslim leaders. So it's actually, factually, it's very difficult. It's almost impossible to get a recommendation from this inter-religious joint forum. So this is the kind of domination. So we are not eliminated, and yet we are put under the power of the dominating group. And a fourth form of exclusion is distancing. It's very interesting. If you look at this picture, it's a very nice picture. Everybody is smiling and is happy. But this is a very wrong picture, because everybody is connected with somebody who is alive. So Chinese with Chinese, Muslim with Muslims. So it is not a mixed group. So this is the kind of distancing. So this is the lowest form of exclusion. So we are there, we are recognized, and yet people do not get acquainted with each other. So there is a distancing, what I call a vertical relation. People only connect with people who are alive. So it's not with people who are different. Now, what should we do if that is the case? So I draw inspiration from Milton Bennett about integration. So he said that actually people live in different stages, and this is that we have to be sensitive and we have to be careful with that people are not at the same platform. So if we want to help the people to get the inter-ethnic and inter-religious reconciliation, we need to be aware where they are, because each state has its own problem and has its own solution. So the first stage is denial. This is when people deny the existence of other groups in society due to isolation or withdrawal. And so what should we do with people like this? We have to bring awareness so that these people can realize that our group is not the only group in society. And what can we do practically? Well, we can do cultural and religious festival, like in our campus, Dutawacana, every year when we are celebrating International Day of Peace. We always have a festival. So we invite people, students from different background of ethnicities and different religions to perform, so that people know that outside themselves, there are a lot of different groups, and they have their own potential, their own uniqueness that we have to appreciate. So we can use this kind of festival, or education of multiculturalism, or even a culinary festival. In Yogyakarta, now it's good that every Chinese New Year, there is a week of culinary festival in which people can try to taste Chinese food, a different kind of Chinese food as being celebrated on the road, on the street. So it's very, very good thing to help people to move on from the states of denial. The second step is defense. And this is, in my experience in Indonesia, where the most people are in. So they realize that there are other groups outside themselves, and yet they feel that their own group is superior compared to the other groups. So they do not, they are not aware of other people. Yes, they are aware, and yet they feel that our group is superior. So what kind of empowerment that we can do? We can build up an understanding so that people from each group can realize that every group has their own uniqueness and yet also the commonalities that we share together. What we can do practically? Well, we can do a fraternal visit to other communities. And here I would like to draw attention. Here is, this is me, and this is during the, what do you call it, Maundy Thursday, a day before the Good Friday. So we always have, church worship, and some of my students, Muslim students, ask whether they can come and can join in, and I will tell them. So they, here you can see, they join in our, this is the Mennonite Church in Yogyakarta. So they join in the Maundy Thursday worship. And from time to time, we also have students from Muslim students who come to our Mennonite Church, and then they ask to us about what is the Mennonite, who are the Mennonites, and what is the doctrine of the Mennonites, and so forth. Just to visit and to learn from each other. Well, it happens that the pastor of this congregation is my wife, so I mean. So it's very easy to get the connection. Yeah, and this is, I also, I mean, from time to time, bring Christians also to other communities to look at, to learn from the other. And the third stage is minimization. This is where people are aware and people appreciate, and yet then they go too far by saying that everybody is the same. So we should bring them to the empowerment to contextualizing that no, not everybody is the same. Everybody has their own context, their own way of thinking, their own belief. And we can do this practically. Well, this is the training, spiritual leader of peace building training that we have from people from different religions. We also have an intensive study on Islam. So where the Christian pastor can really learn about Islam. So it's not just to see that they are the same like us. No, they are different. And what is the difference? And so we really learn deeply. Then the fourth stage is acceptance. This is better when people can accept others who are different and even to respect them. So here we can start to establish communication between these people. Something like interfaith dialogue. So in my course in theology, I always invite those people from the radical Muslims to come to my class and to tell to my students why they burn churches and why they close churches. Because it is not that only that we are annoyed by them, but they are also annoyed by us. So, and we need to know, why they are annoyed by the Christians. So, I invited them to come to tell their stories. And networking, I start here. And fifth stage is adaptation, where we can start to empathize and living comfortably with other people. And here, the communication can be enhanced into interaction. Here we can have a live-in. From time to time, we also bring our students, Christian students, to live in the Islamic boarding school and to learn, really, to have interaction with them, to really learn about how they live and so forth. Joint action, we can also do the training. So this is a joint action. Disaster relief, we can also do here. I am going to speak a little bit more about this kind of experiment. This is where there was an earthquake, a big earthquake in Yogyakarta. And the situation was very messy, and many of the help that was brought into that area was looted along the way. So I called the commander of the Hezbollah Corps, who have been friends for us, to help us. And so they sent 50, they call it soldiers, I mean, to protect two trucks, MCC trucks, full of stable goods, to protect them, and we could go directly into the remote areas and to distribute, the help. And also after that, we also working with them to build a temporary shelter. This is also very interesting because at that time, the director of CODIT, CODIT is the NGO, Catholic NGO from the Netherlands, came to visit me and asked me to help to build 4,000 units of temporary shelters. And so I said to CODIT director that if you only need to build shelter, then you better find somebody else because I'm not interested and I do not have the knowledge to build shelter. And yet, if you allow me to build the shelter with peace building perspective, then I will be interested. And so after a long deal, then he agreed. So he gave us the project, and when we calculated, we needed about 400 carpenters. So what I did was, I asked the Mennonite churches in Jepara to send 200 carpenters, and then I also asked the Hezbollah soldiers to send 200 carpenters. So I blended them, the 400 carpenters, and I divided them into groups of five, consists of Mennonites and the Hezbollah, and who work in the society. And so this is where they work. And this is the shelter that they built. It's pretty nice shelter, actually. I only need like one. And also, finally, this is also, when we want to have a joint action very seriously, quickly, so Dutawacana Christian University also built up a consortium for PhD program. This is an international program. So it consists of Dutawacana Christian University, Gajah Mada Public University, and Sunan Kalijogo Islamic State University. So the three of us joined together, we built up this PhD program. And this person now becomes the Minister of Cabinet Secretary of the Nation. He used to be the President of the Gajah Mada Public University. I jump up my books up here. Well, just put here. And just what I would like to stress is that, as I said, that when we are having a people, we cannot jump. People usually, the first one is denial, and we want to bring them into integration, right? But not everybody is at the same level. That's why I said that we have to be very careful, and we have to be very sensitive. We have to know where the people are, and then for each stage, we have a different kind of empowerment. So when the people is in the stage of denial, then we bring awareness. If the people that we are having is on the stage of defense, then we bring understanding about the uniqueness and commonalities of other people. When the people are going too far into minimization, then we have to bring them into contextualizing so that they know exactly how the other people are thinking and feeling and believing. And when the people are in the state of acceptance, we can bring them communication. This is where many people quite wrongly in doing this, that interfaith dialogue is done, too soon. When people are still in the state of defense, then we are having interfaith dialogue, and it's useless because it will turn the dialogue become a disaster because people are not respecting each other, and so they're only yelling and blaming and cursing other groups. So we have to be very, very careful. Interfaith dialogue is good, and yet people have to be ready for that. So if they're already in the state of acceptance, yes, we can do interfaith dialogue. And even if people can adapting to other people and start respecting other people, then we can build up interaction. And finally, we can have this is the final stage, integration, in which people can respect other people, and we can freely and feel comfortable to go in and out from one particular group to another particular group. I do not have a problem to live among the Muslims, among the Buddhists, among the Confucians, whatever, because I already know the reference. I mean, and we have already frames of reference. Yeah, so that's it. Thank you very much.
Invite everyone just to stand for 10 seconds, just to stretch and try to touch the ceiling or move your body, because it's been sitting for a little while. And as a 48-year-old woman, my body can't sit for too long. So, all right, thank you. Thank you very much, Fernando and Paulus, for a very sophisticated peace theory and practice. The Martyr's Mirror gives us a reflection on Christian suffering, and I think this conference is an opportunity for us to hold up a mirror and write about our collective peacebuilding. What have Mennonites learned about peacebuilding over the last 500 years? And it is almost 500 years. We have some shining contributions and stories to tell. We also have some significant flaws. In the field of peacebuilding, we teach the value of self-reflection, and Reina is one of the prime authors in the field of peacebuilding about how do peacebuilders of any religion or any faith do reflection so that we understand what works well and what is challenging, what didn't work, and what can we learn from our failures. So I think as Mennonites, we need to look in the mirror, both to pat ourselves on the back for our peacebuilding contributions, but also to look at how we might improve our peacebuilding in the future. So over the last year, I have worked on 8 art pieces to reflect on 8 themes related to Mennonite peacebuilding. Each of these art pieces is hanging in the dining hall. And I chose to use art because at EMU we teach about using arts-based pedagogies for reflection and integrating the arts into our teaching. And really a lot of the pieces came first as art and then as words. So I use Mennonite art forms on plain birch panels, which I'll explain a little bit more as I go along. The art pieces both examine and juxtapose the gifts, challenges, and blind spots for integrating an Anabaptist theology of love of enemies. Several of the pieces challenge Mennonites to listen more closely, to remember that Anabaptism was born on the margins of the church, and today we must continue to listen to the voices on the margins. So the first piece is called A Tribe Called Mennonite. When I arrived in Afghanistan in 2010, a tribal elder welcomed me saying, "Ah, you are from the tribe called Mennonite." And this was a compliment. I realized I'm not coming as an individual without a history or as part of the American military complex. I arrived on the coattails of Mennonite humanitarians who had befriended and supported Muslim peacebuilding in the region over many decades. I had a trusted identity that was separate from the U.S. military, and that separation and distinction actually increased my safety and my ability to work and network with Afghan peacebuilding experts. When I worked for MCC Ontario as Native Concerns Coordinator, I just got the slow notice, a First Nations elder taught me not to run away from my heritage, but rather to look for how it can teach me, how it enriches me, the gifts that it gives me. I think many Christians do sort of run away to First Nations elders looking for some redemption from some parts of Christian life. But this Native elder was saying, you need to stay a Mennonite. You can learn from Native elders. But go back to your own religion and learn from it. But also he stressed that culture and ideology are not static. They grow, they learn, they adapt. And First Nations elders know this about their own religion, the Red Way, and certainly Mennonites, we have to learn and adapt as we go along. The wisdom is to capture, I think, the advice that we give children to have both roots and wings. So we're kind of examining our roots, but I think we're also exploring our wings with this conference. Amongst our own tribe, the tribe called Mennonite, we've had not only 500 years of peace building, but also 500 years of internal conflict and division. We have a history of being really ugly and socially persecuting each other. We are really talented at giving icy stares, cold shoulders, and the well-known social torture technique known as the silent treatment. We are quite gifted at loving people in far-off corners of the world, but we are not so gifted at loving our neighbors within the church in the midst of conflict or theological disagreement. It's almost as if Mennonites are addicted to conflict, that our history is made up of the stories about how we split. So this artwork is made out of buttons and hooks and fasteners for a reason. It was one of the first conflicts in the Anabaptist history, whether we would wear buttons or use buttons to fasten our clothing, which were a sign really of the stage and the military used buttons, or whether we would stick with hook and fasteners to fasten our clothing. So isn't it ironic that the first conflict dividing the church is actually on what was used to hold together our clothes? The first arts piece, though, also looks at the tribe called Mennonite in the roots at, despite the vast theological difference in versions of the Mennonite tribe, there is still these roots that hold us together, and the roots are actually more in the practice of community, of service, of music, and of peace. The landscape in the portrait is laid out to the paradoxical words that we sing in the hymn, "Blessed be the tie that binds." Because so many of our hymns, and actually the core of our peace building, is about relationships and improving relationships. The integrity of global Mennonite peace building rests on our ability to work through internal conflicts and develop a coherent ideology that allows for greater theological diversity in our church. And we must model pragmatic peace building in addition to making peace with and for other people. I'm speaking too fast. The second piece of art is a reflection really on the Shenandoah Valley in Virginia, where I live. We think today that conservative and progressive Mennonites hold very different theologies, but again, the practices of creation care and living simply are actually very similar. And this occurred to me one day as I was driving in the Shenandoah Valley in my Toyota Prius with my family, and we passed a horse and buggy, and I thought, now I see them and know they're Mennonite, but do they see me and know that I'm Mennonite? At first sight, the modes of transportation seemed very different. And we were actually on our way to celebrate Hanukkah because my husband's Jewish and we're raising our children to be both Jewish and Mennonite. So there's pretty big theological differences, I recognize. But still, if you pass a church of an old Mennonite church on a Sunday morning, you'll see a line of horse and buggies. And many Mennonite churches in the progressive order, and I was at Fresno Mennonite Church when I pulled in, and there were 20 Prius lined up. And I see John Rudy there. John Rudy is my colleague, and we visited the U.S. Army War College just a few weeks ago, and we both pulled in with our Prius cars, and the guard asked, "Who are you?" "Well, we're from the peace building field," and they're like, "Do all peace builders drive Prius cars?" But the inspiration is actually the same. Of the Prius is fuel efficient. It's thinking about the global community in which we live and how do we live responsibly with that. Also on Mennonite field, on Shenandoah Valley roads, you will see many bicyclists, and it's usually the old Mennonites and the progressive Mennonites who are biking to work. And if you go to the farmer's market, it is the old Mennonites and the progressive Mennonites who are selling vegetables from their garden. So the similarity, actually, in expression is still there. The third portrait is of Mennonites and Muslims, which we've heard about a bit already. This portrait contains images and texts that speak to this 500-year, really, relationship between Mennonites and Muslims. It's on a background of Mennonite quilt squares juxtaposed with Islamic tiles, which, as you can see, even artistically, some of our art forms are similar. Michael Sattler was one of the earliest Anabaptists to be martyred. The state martyred Sattler in large part because of his refusal to fight Muslims. At the top there's a quote from Sattler at his trial: "If the Turks should come, we ought not to resist them, for it is written, 'Thou shalt not kill.'" And this was heretical, and he was put to death for saying these words. Mennonites continue to have a unique relationship with Muslims. At EMU, Muslims come to study peacemaking and tell us they leave as better Muslims. In fact, we have more Muslim women wearing head coverings at EMU than we have Mennonite women wearing head coverings. Three of my closest colleagues have been martyred because of their work for peace in Muslim countries. Glenn Lapp, who's on the left here, was my closest colleague in Afghanistan. He was an MCC volunteer, killed along with 9 other humanitarians, delivering healthcare to remote villages. Javed Akhtar, on the right, was killed in Pakistan by militant groups opposing the peace-building work he did with Just Peace Initiatives, a program that was started by EMU, that's Eastern Mennonite University graduate, Ali Gohar. And Ali went back to Pakistan after getting his degree and started Just Peace Initiatives. Tom Fox at the bottom is a member of Christian Peacemaker Teams in Iraq. He was also my student at EMU. And he was killed because of his human rights advocacy on behalf of Muslim men in Abu Ghraib prison in Baghdad. A top Muslim cleric in London, as well as Muslim Brotherhood leaders in Iran, called for those holding the Christian Peacemaker Team hostage to release these good men. And I think actually this act by a Muslim cleric who some said was the top Al-Qaeda spiritual leader in Europe, calling for their release, calling the hostage takers to release these good men, is actually a very profound moment in the history of what's called the global war on terror. And it really needs some young student to go and research this more consistently, because there have been some remarkable outreach from Muslim leaders specifically to Mennonites and Christian Peacemaker Team members. In an increasingly Islamophobic world, Mennonite voices are on the margins when it comes to Muslims, but we have a unique and important voice in reaching out to Muslims and working together for peace. The fourth portrait is out of order for my slides. Okay. Black, red, and yellow lives matter. I grew up in Bluffton Mennonite Church singing, "Jesus loves the little children, all the children of the world, red and yellow, black and white, they are precious in God's sight." And yet, I rarely saw anyone who was not white at the pulpit of my church. Pennsylvania Dutch Mennonites use the art form called fracture to decorate important documents or to write out sacred passages from the Bible and texts and place them on their wall. So I wanted to do this for my own context because I think Fractor's decorative style highlights the importance of reminding us that all black lives matter and red lives matter and yellow lives matter. Mennonites cannot be a prophetic voice for peace if all of our institutions are headed by white, Swiss, German, and Russian Mennonites. We have to break out of the ethnic hold on Mennonite institutions to do more to affirm the leadership of Anabaptists with African, Asian, Latin American, and indigenous origin. Tribes often share a genetic code, but more importantly, they share an ideology and a purpose. Ironically, there is a genetic disorder within Mennonites, and I have Mennonite ancestors all the way back in my family tree, so I have an extra heavy dose of this genetic disorder known as Ehlers-Danlos syndrome. And it's not a fun disease. It's basically all of my joints and tendons tend to fall apart. My sister's had many surgeries. Both of my children are constantly wearing braces and taping their limbs together. They rip and tear. And the irony is this genetic disorder that Mennonites have is the perfect symbol for how our church continues to fall apart. The Nigerian novelist Chinua Achebe wrote a book called Things Fall Apart. And I think, again, black lives matter, red lives matter, yellow lives matter, because the future of the church really requires genetic diversity. And coming in to the Swiss Mennonite Russian tangled knot that we have and helping us solve our internal conflicts. I think white Mennonites also need to spend more of their time taking responsibility for whiteness by challenging white power structures and working with poor white communities, like my family neighbors who fly the Confederate flag and have Trump signs in their front yard. And in all ways, they are the Trump Taliban. They look and act just like I saw the Taliban act in Afghanistan. The next portrait is of Mennonites and sexual violence. This martyr's mirror image of Dirk Willems rescuing the man who was chasing him because he's an Anabaptist is a common symbol of Mennonite love of enemies. And this version Dirk symbolizes the Mennonite Church, reaching out to save a perpetrator of sexual violence, as we see the churches so often reach out to save the dignity and to save the humanity of the perpetrator and their professional positions, while really trying to silence the women who are screaming in the water, yelling, please reach out and help me too. Advocates against sexual violence witness the church's one-sided approach to protect the dignity and life of the perpetrator. Victims of sexual violence are on the margins. How is it that the church most concerned with state violence has fallen significantly behind the state's efforts to prevent and respond to sexual violence? I work at the United Nations, at the World Bank. They are all fully organized to prevent sexual violence, and they have many, many programs, far more than our Mennonite institutions do. Mennonites are called to love both victims and offenders, but actually find it very hard to do both at the same time. Our peace theology hasn't really caught up with the dilemma of how to keep victims in the center of our peace building when the victims challenge the church's integrity. In sexualized violence, the church rushes to love the enemy, the perpetrator. We have to listen to these voices to have a Mennonite peace building with integrity that's able to prevent sexualized violence within the church. The next portrait is of the Pink Menno movement. Early Anabaptists who did not conform to official church doctrine were convicted of heresy. Authorities ordered guards to construct an iron torture device that would literally screw the tongue of the condemned, making it impossible for Anabaptists to speak at their executions to those who came to watch their deaths. Today's Mennonite institutions also silence Anabaptists who do not conform. Pink Menno is an organization of lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender, queer, and intersex people, and those who stand in solidarity with them. Pink Menno representatives have been consistently excluded from official church processes, and they feel silenced, as my friend and student Christian Parks here in the lower right-hand corner. In the artwork, Jennifer Yoder of Pink Menno is juxtaposed in the etching from the Martyr's Mirror plate, illustrating the application of a tongue screw first heated in the fire. In the upper left-hand corner, a cloud of Pink Menno witnesses hold up their hands in solidarity. I think Jennifer Yoder and Christian Parks, the two Anabaptist young people, actually are the perfect Anabaptist witnesses today. They have devoted their life to peace and justice. They speak out on behalf of a Jesus-centered peace building, and they are continuing to witness to the church about their silencing, even in the midst of the humiliation that they feel. The next portrait is of my own work of working on the margins of peace building by trying to plant peace in the Pentagon. When I went to Iraq with Mennonite Central Committee in 2005, Iraqi peace builders told me directly, it's great that you Mennonites teach and support people in community-based peace building, but what we really need you to do is to teach your government and military about peace building. And it was like the fourth time that people in other countries had looked me directly in the eyes and said, what are you doing about your government? They said, peace building doesn't land in a helicopter. Peace building grows from the ground up. And it's that metaphor of planting seeds of peace that we have to think about. And I used the Mennonite art form known as Scherenschnitte, or paper cutting, to try to improvise a paper cutting of what would planting seeds in the Pentagon look like. Surely I know that most of the seeds will not grow, and it's very messy business, and I'm often discouraged. But when I started attending and speaking at military conferences and training military units in peacebuilding, some Mennonites questioned whether this was a Mennonite approach to peacebuilding. For me, I see it as a natural conclusion of the journey of Mennonite peacebuilding and loving those with whom we disagree. So I think for some peacebuilders, they think, oh, our enemies are the Palestinians or Iranians, and we are loving them. But neither Palestinians nor Iranians are our enemies. They are the enemies of the state. And so when I ask, how do we love the state and how do we love the military, it's almost as if I'm saying something heretical. And just a couple months ago, I was saying, we love the Palestinians and we reach out to Palestinians. How are we reaching out and how are we loving Israelis? And a Mennonite close colleague said, well, we can't do that. Why not? In peacebuilding, we don't even use the word enemy. And I think in Mennonite peacebuilding, we need to get this word enemy out of our language, actually, because in peacebuilding in the field, we talk about stakeholders, those who have a stake in the conflict. And everybody, especially those who are charged with waging war or containing violence, need to be engaged. So we will not build peace in the world until we engage the military and the police. And finally, the last portrait is of the two-hand approach to peacebuilding. Mennonite theologians have often advocated a two-kingdom theology, where Mennonites live in God's kingdom, while the state rules the secular kingdom. But two-kingdom theology does not give us an adequate platform for understanding the challenges of peace-building in the real world. We're not separated anymore, we're engaging with the powers. Mennonite peace-building instead requires a two-hand theology, where we both reach out to hand to love our enemies, to build relationships, to engage with people that we disagree with, while we have one hand up in resistance to injustice and to push and advocate for peace and justice. And so when I'm at the Pentagon, it's both. I see the humanity of the people I'm working with, and I'm pushing for justice and for change. I think two-hand theology provides Mennonite peacebuilding with a biblical focus on both love of enemies and victims through a handout and relationship, while acknowledging the structures of power and privilege that must be pushed to bring us along. In two-hand theology, we must find ways of loving the Taliban and the US military. We must find ways to demand that Black Lives Matter and to find a way to love the police, to love Palestinians and Israelis, to love victims of sexual abuse and perpetrators. So in summary, we need to model peace building within Mennonite church relationships, increase diversity of leadership in Mennonite institutions, listen and affirm voices on the margins of both church and society, challenge white power structures, care for all victims, especially victims of sexual violence, and use this two-handed approach. Thank you.
Thanks to all three of you for those provocative words and inspiration for the days ahead. We all know, and I know, that all three of these speakers have much more than 15 minutes to say. And you will have many opportunities over the next few days to draw them out further on the sampling they gave you of their ideas and their wisdom. We intentionally wanted to fill you up in this first plenary session, fill you with ideas and thoughts and inspiration that would guide us in the days ahead. Several years ago, I had the privilege to participate in the ordination of the first Mennonite woman in the Evangelical Mennonite Church of Congo in Mujimai, Democratic Republic of Congo. That was a 6-hour service. So I don't feel badly about a 2-hour opening plenary. There'll be many opportunities, as I've said, over the next few days to talk more about these ideas. Right now, I'd like to introduce some important people. First of all, my colleagues, faculty, staff, and administration here at Conrad Grebel University College have been very generous, supportive, and helpful throughout the planning. So I thank them collectively here, and I hope you have that opportunity to do so while you're here. We have a set of volunteers in blue GMP t-shirts. Can you stand up, blue-shirted friends? We have a larger group that you'll see throughout the conference. They are mainly graduate students from our Master of Peace and Conflict Studies and Master of Theological Studies programs. They'll be helping you find your way throughout the building. They will be taking notes in all the concurrent sessions and assisting in those classrooms on Friday and Saturday. And they are led by our staff person, Kelly Brown. Stand up, Kelly. Many of you in the audience are assisting with interpretation. Today we thank Paul Stuckey and Sarah Koopman in the back. Thank you for the support. The interpretation services are being coordinated by Rachel Reist. Rachel, with equipment support from Hans Peters from Mennonite Church Eastern Canada. And so you can find Rachel. Rachel, wave your hand if you have interpretation questions. Rebecca Gibbons is the overall events and conference coordinator here at Conrad Grable. I don't think Rebecca is in the room right now. She oversees the registration desk and the logistical arrangements for this event. That's probably why she's not here right now. I'd just like to take a moment just to note the very significant female leadership in making this event happen. Just have to say. And most important, all of you will have communicated at some point with Mary Lou Clausen, the Global Mennonite Peace Building Conference Coordinator. She has done a stellar job of bringing all this together. Also teaches in the Peace and Conflict Studies program here, and so I'd like to invite her up for some important announcements.
Well, thank you all. It's been a great pleasure to work at this conference and work with Marlene and Raina, who are amazing women to work with. They both see the big picture and attend to details, and so it's been a gift for me and a learning experience for me as well. So I say welcome. Or as I said in Northern Nigeria about a year ago, just before we were leaving, in Hausa language they say, Sanuda Zua. Sanuda Zua. So as I've had the privilege and joy of interacting with you over the information highway, I'm glad to see that you've made your way here through the air and by land travel safely. And now we can get to see each other face to face, and I can put faces to the names that I've been working with all this time. When you registered, you received a blue bag with a program and a folder of additional materials. Please put your name on your program and keep these with you to review the information therein whenever you need it. The program outlines our concurrent sessions and some other important activities that are available for interaction during this conference. The place here at Grable is not difficult to get to know. At first, of course, it can be confusing, but it's not difficult. But there is also a vast campus around us, and so the maps in your materials also will help guide you to find certain locations that you need. And if you need particular direction help, please feel free to see the folks at our registration desk. In your name tag, you were told when you were registered, but as a reminder, are all your meal tickets. And if there is some confusion between what you thought you'd ordered and what is in your name tag, please come and see me. And for those of you who did not buy meals, there may be some tickets available, very few in some cases, although I think we have a few for tomorrow Friday lunch and Saturday lunch. So you can check at that table to see if there's any available for purchase if you did not order any in advance. The registration desk has been staffed by many different people, but our main person that will be there over the duration of the conference is Neve Kinsella. And there's others there. There's also a message board available. And I have overheard somebody saying, well, we want to get together for a noon hour conversation about X. I suggest that if you have such ideas, that would be a place you could put a notice up. And if we all keep checking, we may find a group of people with like ideas to connect. So this evening, we are going to enjoy the concert Voices for Peace. It's at 7:30 in Theater of the Arts. Now that's on campus. There's details on page 11 of your program. The theater is a 5-minute walk from this campus. There will be volunteers along the way to help you, to guide you. It's kind of in that direction. And There'll be people around to help you get there. There's also lots of people from this community that you can follow along with to get over to, as we say, across the creek, because you will actually cross a small bridge when you go to the Theater of the Arts. We also welcome you to engage this experience through social media. Some of us here are not so great on Twitter. We have a Facebook page, so you're welcome to like our Global Mennonite Peacebuilding Conference Facebook page, add your photos and comments, and also send out Twitter messages. And the hashtag is circulated around the building. It's hashtag Mennos for Peace, four being the number four. Oh yes, and also to remind you that the ticket for the concert tonight is in your envelope. And the tickets for the other evening events are also in your envelopes. And again, if you don't need them, you're welcome to return them to our registration desk. And if for some reason there's not one in there and you want to be going, please also see us. So thank you again for joining us for this exciting time together. And if there's any questions, please feel free to ask us. And we can also say, one of the mantras we've been saying to each other as we've been going is please. The words we need to say are please, thank you, and I'm sorry. So, in a true Canadian fashion. I will now invite Paul Heidenbrecht, director of the MSU Center for Peace Advancement, to invite you to the art exhibit and close the gathering.
Good afternoon. Let me add my greetings on behalf of the participants in the Mennonite Savings and Credit Union Center for Peace Advancement. Greetings from them as well. Over 30 individuals who are part of three separate organizations and eight new emerging initiatives in our incubator who are also sharing your ambitions but coming from many other traditions. So again, greetings and welcome. The call for proposals for this event indicated that we intended to bring together artists along with academics and practitioners and church workers, artists from around the world. They're intentional about wanting to give expression to peace-building ideals through the arts and invited proposals for the presentation of visual, literary, and performing arts. Going beyond the Voices for Peace concert that has already been highlighted, I want to draw your attention now to seven additional artistic contributions to this event. These are noted on page 11 of your program, but I'll give you a little more context briefly for each of them and encourage you to walk around and explore our campus, our buildings, but also to explore these exhibits. And an ideal time is during the reception immediately following this initial plenary. So first, located on the wall opposite the windows in the lower atrium, the same floor we're on now, just so you have your bearings, is a painting called Green Line by Rhonda Harder Epp from Edmonton, Alberta. This painting is inspired by the habit of British officials to draw green lines on maps in places such as Israel-Palestine or Cyprus. And it focuses our attention on the arbitrariness of political divisions. What is neat and clean on a map is messy and heartrending for families and communities. Along the hallway, outside of classroom 1208, also on the first floor, you can find Per Resistance, Images of Peace Building, which is a series of sharp, monochromatic photographs by Caldwell Manners. This series documents the life and the challenges of some of the communities that Christian Peacemaker Teams Columbia accompanies, a context that Caldwell knows well. Underscoring that the work of resistance is taken on by ordinary people with extraordinary courage. Going up one floor, along the hallway between the upper atrium and the dining room, you can view Frontline Peace Builders, another series of photographs, this one in vivid color. Taken by Dave Clausen, these photos depict three remarkable partners of Mennonite Central Committee in Nigeria, Margaret Ahmed, Boniface Anthony, and Amina Ahmed. Dave Clausen, by the way, is a former country representative for MCC in Nigeria and currently resides in Kitchener-Waterloo. Once in the dining room, we can take a closer look at A Tribe Called Mennonite, Lisa Shirk's exhibit of 8 pieces that were previewed just a few moments ago. So I won't add any more to her eloquent insights of the genesis of those pieces. Heading up to the third floor, I would invite you to take some time. I invite you to take some time to absorb the extensive archival exhibit on Canadian conscientious objectors in the Second World War. This would be a great preparation, by the way, for Theatre of the Beat's play on Saturday night, Yellow Bellies, an alternative history to World War II. The title for this exhibit uses another slang term for conscientious objectors, Conchies. Conchies speak, Ontario Mennonites in Alternative Service. And it was curated by Lorene Harder Gissing, Grable's archivist librarian. Elements can be found in the Mennonite Archives of Ontario Gallery on the landing, just outside the library, and throughout the library itself, beside the help desk, in the gallery facing Westmount Road, and in the Lorraine Roth reading room. In the main foyer of the library, you can also experience Jonathan and Paul Rudy's harmony harp. Now, you won't actually see this, but you can experience the work that Jonathan, a peacemaker in residence at Elizabethtown College in Pennsylvania, and Paul, a professor at the University of Missouri at Kansas City, you can get a sense of their project through the sounds that will be broadcast in the atrium of the library. A harp that's actually located in Perry, Kansas. The soundscape will be playing audibly for the next hour or during the duration of the reception, although you will also be able to access it from a dedicated workstation throughout the time of the conference. So our final exhibit is located on the fourth and final level of the college. So we're working our way up in the Grable Gallery at the heart of the Center for Peace Advancement. Entitled Stories and Art from Iraqi Kurdistan, this exhibit consists of 28 drawings and paintings collected by Kathy Moorhead Thiessen as part of a Christian Peacemaker Team's project. First exhibited in Winnipeg, where Kathy resides, at the Mennonite Heritage Center Gallery, it offers stories from Iraqi Kurds, Syrian Kurds, Yazidis, Assyrian Christians, and Iraqi Arabs who now find themselves living alongside each other as a result of displacement. So please join me in thanking all of these artists, curators, and supporting organizations who made this diverse and stimulating collection of exhibits possible. Once again, over the next hour during this reception, it's a great opportunity to experience these contributions to our conference much more clearly than on this stream. But you can also feel free, and should feel free, to stop and linger throughout the conference as you have the occasion to pass by these significant works. Refreshments now await us in the upper atrium, and dinner will begin at 5:30. So thank you.